Welcome to our video where we're doing our little meager, feeble best to actually practice, attune our valuing, and get ready to like outstretch our arms like glider wings, like this. And then gently step off of the tree branch. And we find the light of non-relative loveliness and beauty. It is buoyant. It's buoyant. And we can float on that. We just float on that. Like a glider. Like a glider. We don't require a whole bunch of effort so we don't drop our plunge. There's no abyss to it. There's no abyss to it. So we're just stretching out our wings is all we're doing. We're not trying to say jump, 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 jump. No, we're not looking to jump. We're not looking to jump here. Nobody's pushing somebody off a ledge or pushing a branch. Come on, go, push. Because we might just back up and say, and go back like that bird in the bird in the tree saying, I don't know about this. This is I'm not so sure. We'd rather be like this one right here that gracefully, smoothly, gently, just like a little breeze of air just sort of gets under our wings, our outstretched wings, and lifts us just ever so imperceptibly. We don't, not even aware that we've left the branch, and we're just abiding now in this thisness. And it's like that. So the time spent to keep working on attunement, practicing, works on the continuity problem. So we have a soft takeoff. So then we have a soft landing in this vision of oneness, the vision of beauty, the vision of the light of loveliness, the clear light of loveliness. So this morning, I did have this very, very clear understanding. The whole thing just fit together. And when you get that sense of clarity about something, you can't really use a bunch of words and phrases to add them up together to equal that sort of holistic, total clarity. It never equals it, does it? It never equals it. It's like total assurance. If you have total assurance, you try to explain it to somebody, it never is going to equal up to the assurance that you have. But in short, I saw that we don't have to do anything. We don't have to change anything. This world is like a vast machine. It's the machinery that we have been working on, like a gigantic, colossal machine, or a conglomeration of machinery, all hooked up together, designed to change reality. Designed to change reality, or so we think. The truth is that reality can't be changed. So all this machinery is useless. Totally useless to us. However, we have a continuity problem. And that is, we are afraid to just say, okay, goodbye machinery. I'll never see you again. We're finished right now, this instant, forever. Boom, we're back in reality. Really, totally not even aware that it's possible to change it. Or the idea that it's possible to change what we want to change is vanished. And we know there is no change. We don't even think about it. We're not ready for that break, seeming break in continuity. It's not literally a break, but it seems to us like a huge break in continuity. So what do we do with this machinery? What do we do with this machinery? This colossus, this Frankenstein, what we've built, that's trying to destroy us. What do we do with it? We simply utilize it to remind us of reality, to solve the continuity problem. Easy. What do? When you get lemons, you make lemonade. You get this massive, colossal conglomeration of machinery designed to try and force a change upon reality, and we see that it's useless to us. We say, okay, let's just see it all as equally beautiful. Since it is actually completely meaningless and completely useless, it has no intrinsic beauty to us. This world has no intrinsic beauty, actually. It's not what we really want. And so it doesn't have what we really want, so it's not truly beautiful for us. So what do we do? What do? We decide, let's see all of it as just equally beautiful, without exception, the entire mass, conglomerate mass of this huge machine and machinery, all hooked up. We just say, it's all so beautiful. All of it is equally beautiful. And then we simply view this beauty, and it reminds us of reality, where everything is totally beautiful for us, because it's what we really want. It has meaning, it has purpose. So this smoothed out, one singular loveliness, this light of loveliness, this clear light of loveliness, rests upon everything equally. That's the whole point of it. The whole point of it is that it rests upon everything equally. That's the whole deal. That is the deal. Okay, that's the one and only deal there is. It rests upon everything equally. It's non-crystallized, non-congealing, non-compounded. It is smooth, seamless. No clumping. It is non-clumping. Non-aggregating, non-crystallizing. The density is the same everywhere. And so we simply view this world that way, with the vision of oneness, the vision of the light of beauty, the light of loveliness. Just view the world that way. And it doesn't matter what is happening with this machinery. It doesn't matter in the slightest bit what is happening. There could be a golden age, we could be in Kali Yuga in the most terrible wars, everybody could be living, everybody could be dying. Nothing that happens, none of our thoughts, or none of the thoughts of this machine, it's actually, the thoughts that we're thinking, the reactions we're thinking, that's all part of the machinery. It's not us at all. It's meaningless to us, actually. It is meaningless. Because the design to change reality is futile, so it's meaningless. So all these emotions and thoughts and reactions of this world we call life are actually totally meaningless to us, have no meaning. We keep hoping that someday they will be meaningful. Maybe we'll meet the love of our life. We keep thinking, I just need to meet the right person and they will make my life meaningful. No, they won't. They will not. You will never meet anyone who makes your life meaningful. Only the vision of the non-relative light of loveliness, the light of oneness, the light of beauty, only that reminds us of what is meaningful. It reminds us. See, we have the meaningful within us already. It's reality. So all we need to do is to be reminded of it. So the light of loveliness is not meaningful in itself, because it's shining on a meaningless world, but it's pragmatic in that it reminds us of meaning. It's a reminder of meaning. So, we don't need to try and make more of it, more out of it than there is. But we will never meet that person, that thing, that puts it all together, that's meaningful for us. It's impossible. Because the only way we can be reminded of reality is this equal vision, equal light, supreme, clear, all good light, shining, resting, gently resting upon everything. All thoughts, all emotions, all reactions, all considerations, all ups, all downs, every circumstance imaginable in this machinery, resting upon it all equally, abiding upon it all equally, in total stillness and total certainty and total serenity. Only that reminds us of what has meaning. Only that reminds us of what has meaning. There are no special relationships in reality. All is one. It's one totality. Now we can practice in many different ways, and the practice leads us to the vision of oneness. So there are different ways of practicing, depending on your predisposition. If you're a very sociable person, if the part of the machinery that you're engaged with, that you're identifying with, this machine is sociable, that's part of the machinery, then you will do sociable practice. If part of the machinery that you think has something to do with your responsibility, it tends to be more of an introverted type of person, then you'll have probably a different practice. I mean, there are extroverted aspects of the machinery, introverted aspects of it. For me, I'm more introverted. Not very extroverted at all. Easily, I go back into introversion. So, of course, you know, you see these extroverted people and they're meeting everybody, hugging everybody, socializing, dining with them. They have to be around all these people all the time. And I say, how in the world, you know, it's impossible for me to do that. How can I possibly do that? And then maybe they see someone like me and just who's like in a comfortable living in a cave. You know, this is like a cave, and yeah, I'm perfect. I'm very okay with that, for the most part. I go out among people, but I don't feel comfortable socializing really, because people's attitudes are not in the same place. Their efforts, everything about them, I'm saying, wow, they're not focused in on right spiritual practice. So I get distracted. I don't want to be distracted. So different styles of practice, probably, I would say. And both styles can work. Both styles can work. But we're not trying to do all styles. We're not trying to be all things to all people. We're trying to be pragmatic. We're trying to do what really works for those who have the time to practice in their cave, or in their car, or in their mind. And we're not necessarily, for instance, like in an encounter group where people are sharing their thoughts with one another and talking with one another and stuff like that. That's one model. But a lot of people really are not interested in that. And maybe cannot afford it also. Cannot afford to go to these retreats and go see these teachers and all this stuff. Who can afford that? I don't know. I guess there's a whole lot of people with a whole lot of money, but I'm not one of them. So it doesn't cost anything to sit in a cave and go over this continuity practice. It's free. I try to make everything that I do free to everybody, and Creative Commons to everybody, so nobody feels jittery, you know, about ownership, copyright, trademark, all this kind of stuff, which you know, equates to like money. Poor people are jittery about a whole bunch of stuff. So it's very interesting. In a previous life, I was very wealthy, very, very wealthy. And this life, very, very poor. In fact, I don't want to talk about what the future looks like, because hopefully it won't get to that. But I totally understand what it's like to be poor, to feel like it's best just to not go out. What if you get a ticket? I can't afford to pay a parking ticket, a moving violation. I can't afford anything. It's better just to stay in your cave. You know, it's better. Occasionally, I scrape together enough money for a round of golf. Cheap, very cheap round of golf. And that's it. That's it. But even then, when I'm driving, I'm worried about, I hope I don't get a ticket, because what a ticket. You go through a red light, it's $250. You go in the carpool lane. So everything I do, I'm scared. I'm scared because of lack of money. It's a terrible thing, actually. But so people that are poor, they feel, you know, like ostracized from society. And they feel they can't go to retreats. All this stuff, spirituality, you know. Mujis in Rishikesh. You know, who can go to Rishikesh and hang out there for several weeks? You know, who can do that? I guess if you're young and you've got a trust fund or I don't know what. I don't know how people do it. But they do. Some do. But we don't have to go to Rishikesh and hang out on the banks of the Ganga and get dysentery or whatever else you get there. Those are for the adventurous and the intrepid, etc. But we can sit right where we are. We can sit right where we are. And we can actually do incredibly profound practice that will bring us to the vision of oneness. Right where we are, even if we're poor, even if we're old, even if we're sick. You know, what about the older people who can't travel like that to all these retreats and stuff, you know? What about them? What about the feeble people? What about the sick people? What about the infirm? What about them? You know, I've been all those things. I am all those things, actually. I can't travel. I can't go anywhere. I don't. So they feel cut off. What about them? You know, this world seems to be like fly anywhere. You know, are you kidding? Okay, that's just a pipe dream. So, what about them? So I'm determined to at least keep that in mind of all those people who really can't do any of that stuff. And they shouldn't sit around thinking, wow, I have something wrong with me. I just have to wait until I can't do that stuff. If I can't, well, I'm out of luck, you know. I can't go see such and such a teacher, fly up to Toronto, or fly to Florida, or go to Costa Rica, or go to Rishikesh, or go to Hawaii, or, you know, wherever, go down to Arizona, I don't know, be globetrotting, go, you know, oh, sure, go for a week, it's only, you know, $4,000 or something. We have to say, we can't do it, can't do it, can't do it. Can't even buy books online, can't even do this, can't even do that. So we have limited resources, and it seems like this is never addressed. It's never really addressed at all. It's a bizarre thing. It is a bizarre thing. I remember a long ago, 1978, I think, I went to see a teacher, and there was this cost to get into this one-day retreat thing, and I couldn't afford it. And they said, we have sliding scales. So I said, okay, I'm gonna try anyway. I felt so guilty, you know, couldn't even pay it. And they put me through this incredible song and dance, and it was just awful, making me feel like, you know, they didn't want me there. They really didn't want me there. I think they just saying, you know, if you can't afford to pay, you know, we The attitude was not benevolent at all towards me. I felt like an interloper. You know, it was awful, just awful. You go to see other teachers, like donations, such as, well, of course, it's in order to keep their tax-free status, it has to be set as a donation. But it's not a donation, it's actually a fee. That's a fee. So I just don't go. I just don't go. And I know there are people like that are really tight. Their budget is very, very tight. Very tight. God, though, some way provides. This is back, it seems, looks like, well, look at this studio. This is incredible. Well, this backdrop I found in a dump. Just found it in a dump. I cleaned it, I washed it, I repaired it. So I got it for free. The flowers are in the garden. I got them for free. So, you know, it's not sumptuous. It's a very completely low budget setup here entirely. And yet, it's fine. It's really good. It's no problem. It's no problem. Because what's important is our focus, our determination, and right spiritual practice. And the fact that we repent and say, hey, I've forgotten what reality is all about. I've forgotten. Think of all those in the world who refuse to repent. What they're saying is, no, I know reality. I'm perfectly aware of reality. I just happen to be playing with this, you know, dance of dual. I'm just playing with it. But sure, I know reality. You know? No, think about that. How many people are that way? Just about everybody. This is totally dishonest. Totally dishonest. We have almost totally forgotten about reality. Like it's the farthest thing from our mind possible. We are not just playing with this stuff here for the fun of it. That is a total denial. It is a total denial. We are playing with all this stuff because we've totally forgotten reality and we're absolutely terrified to go back because we don't have a clue what it's like or how to function there. That is the truth. That is the truth. And so the greatest step anyone can take is to admit, God, I have completely forgotten what my home was like. I have been pursuing the construction of this vast machinery which is designed to annihilate reality. And in doing so, in order to believe it's possible, I've actually totally forgotten what reality is like. I cannot even conceive of something that is invulnerable. I cannot conceive of anything that is immaculate. I cannot conceive of anything that is incorruptible. I cannot conceive of anything that's endless, that's everywhere, that is one. I cannot conceive of anything that can't be split or fragmented. Well, cannot conceive of any of that. So, we've forgotten. We have forgotten. We have forgotten. And of course, when we admit that to God, we say, God, I've forgotten. We're admitting that we've been engaged in trying to change reality. That's the only reason we would forget. It's the only reason. So we're admitting, yeah, hey, I've been trying to build this machine that can destroy you. And I feel like an idiot. You know, it's ridiculous. It's a whimsical waste of time. So can you please remind me of reality so that I may return there, so that I may awaken to it out of my coma? Will you please help me awaken from this coma of forgetfulness? At that point, we actually become genuine, authentic spiritual pilgrims, authentic spiritual pilgrims, because then we start paying attention to some practices. The continuity technique. I don't have an estrangement problem, I have a continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. The estrangement problem has no value. Only the vision of oneness has value. You begin to definitely reorient yourself to waking from the coma. Whereas before, you're playing this game of like, nah, I haven't really forgotten. I'm just having a vacation. Oh, no, 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 no. I'm just taking a break from reality. No, I'm just having fun, God. I can go back in this instant if I wanted to, but I don't really want to because this world's really interesting. So all these excuses. No, no, I'm involved with a lot of relationships, a lot of a good career. I have a good life. I enjoy this life. I love this life. What more could I want? I'm not interested in going back right now, but if I was, it'd be no problem. Now, all these rationalizations that we get prevent us from actually practicing. They prevent us. And for sure, if you have those rationalizations, you cannot practice effectively. But if you say, hey, there's absolutely nothing about this life or world that I really want, nothing whatsoever. What I really want is to remember reality. That's what I really want. That's only what I want. Only that is what I want. Only that is what I want. Only the remembrance of reality is what I want. I don't want anything else. Then you can really practice. Now, of course, this doesn't come all at once, this will, aligned will. It comes gradually, but you have some breakthroughs in your life where you need to use the momentum of those breakthroughs. Really, you do. So one of the help that some of those in the world who can be helpful is to encourage you to ride the momentum of those breakthroughs, of those peak moments. Ride the momentum of those peak moments, of those breakthroughs. And get used to breakthroughs. Get used to it. Keep your stride going. Keep your stride. Set a stride. Keep it going. Keep it going. Increase it a little bit. Increase it. Go a little quicker. That's the most helpful thing. Don't squander the momentum that you have. Don't squander it. So I have to tell myself this all the time. Don't squander it. I make a lot of momentum today. Finally, I said, I got to have lunch. And I said, well, maybe I'll watch a baseball game. It's almost like a spring training game. Well, the game has been rained out, fortunately. And I said, good. I don't want to waste the time. So I came out here, rearranged the set, and kept the momentum going. The genius on the path, your genius has to be to keep the momentum going. Preserve your momentum like it was more important than your breath. Or at least as important as your breath. And so when people try to mess with your momentum, which is why I stay away from people, you know, that is not good. That gets me really, really unhappy when people mess with your momentum, because it's super hard to win this momentum, to get this momentum. It requires an unbelievable amount of desire, will, motivation, application to get this momentum going. And so you don't want to break that momentum for anyone. I don't care who it is. If they are going to break your momentum, it's not worth it. I don't care if it's the most important person on this planet. You do not put that ahead of your momentum. You put your momentum ahead of that, for sure. I've been around some instances of bigwigs, you know, and I didn't shake their hand, I didn't drink them, because I said, you know what? I can tell that they're not going to help my momentum. It's going to hurt my momentum. So I just, no, I'm not going to engage with them. If somebody offered you, for instance, $1 million, go see this movie fest, you know, and spend a weekend watching all these horrible movies, you know, which is a reiteration, horrible movie. It's a doubling down. All movies are really horrible, actually. Go see a horrible movie. If they said, I'll pay you $1 million, would you do it? I'd have to say no. No way. No way. No way. A billion. They're like, you just watch TV every night for 5 hours, you know, these network channels or whatever. Could be cable, terrible stuff, horrible. I'll give you all the money in the world if you just do that. What would I say? No. No way. My momentum is not for sale at any price. So this is the attitude. My momentum is not for sale at any price. My momentum is not for sale at any price. The vision of oneness is the only value there is. And it can't be bought. It's bought and purchased by my momentum. So my momentum is not for sale at any price. Because the meaningless has no value. It doesn't matter how much value you try to place upon it. It has no value. It intrinsically is valueless. The attempt to change reality is intrinsically valueless. Doesn't matter how much time you spend on it, building a machine. Doesn't matter how many lives you spend on it. It doesn't matter how much attention you put on it. It is intrinsically, inherently valueless. And will always be so. So don't get suckered into purchasing the valueless. Somebody giving you a present. Here's a present for you. All you have to do is hang out with it forever. But it's valueless. So I will not spend my time in valueless endeavors. Okay. So we have done a lot of practicing recently. And I'm going to shift gears. This is just spontaneous, but I happen to have the book here, which is actually recommends all sorts of practices. Now, I don't particularly do these particular practices, but they certainly have a lot of very good. By grace I live. By grace I am released. By grace I live. By grace I am released. I am among the ministers of God. I am among the ministers of God. For it is the light, it is the vision of oneness that and that alone that I seek. Let me perceive forgiveness as it is. Let me perceive forgiveness as it is. It is the light of beauty resting upon all equally. That is the forgiveness that I seek. It is the remembrance of reality that I seek. Salvation comes from my one self, from my one self. In the East, the term the self refers to the oneness, the vision of oneness. Abide in the self means abide in this vision of oneness. That's the term the self. The vision of the absolute would be this intermediate step. So abide in the vision of the self, the oneness. So salvation comes from my one self. Yes, it comes from perceiving this light of non-relative loveliness resting upon everything as it is, resting upon everything as it is. There is no love but God's. 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 There isn't some other love. There's not ego love. There's no love but God's. My mind holds only what I think with God. My mind holds only what I think with God. And only the vision of oneness has value as a thought for me. Only the vision of oneness reminds me of God, of reality, and sets me eventually free from all this whimsicality. Only salvation can be said to cure. Only salvation can be said to cure. Exactly. Only the vision of oneness can be said to cure. Only there is no other cure other than to be saved from this whimsical dream. There's no other way to be saved except to be reminded of reality so that we can then agree, let's stop this whimsical idea of trying to change reality. So only salvation can be said to cure. It's the only cure there is. There is no other cure. Right? Let not my mind deny the thought of God. the thought of God. This also is synonymous with the name of God, which is synonymous with the vision of oneness. God has one name within this sphere of this whimsical dream. Ultimately, God is nameless, but in this intermediate step, God has one name, meaning the name of God rests upon everything equally. The light of loveliness is the name of God. The light of beauty is the name of God. It is the thought of God. Let not my mind deny the thought of God. Your grace is given me, or God's grace is given me. I claim it now. God's grace is given me. I claim it now. The vision of oneness is given me. I claim it now. The name of God is given me. I claim it now. The light of loveliness is given me. I claim it now. The light of the one transparent, immaculate beauty resting upon all is given me. I claim it now. I claim it now. I want the peace of God. I want the peace of God. It's intention, will. I want the peace of God. I want only the peace of God. I want only the name of God. I want only the thought of God. I want only the vision of oneness. One moment. So I want only the peace of God. I want only the peace of God. That is it. I want only the peace of God. I want only the name of God. I want only the thought of God. I want only the vision of oneness. I don't want anything else. Because anything else is meaningless. Anything else is meaningless. Salvation of this world depends upon me. So it depends upon me, the vision of oneness, I have to accept it. If I don't accept it, the world still looks condemned. It's condemned to this activity of trying to change reality. Wherein I choose the vision of oneness, the light of loveliness. There's no more condemnation upon the world. Now, it's simply a means to remind me of reality. And I've lifted the condemnation off the world. I have saved the world, as it were. Lifted the condemnation off of the world. I feel the love of God within me now. I feel the vision of oneness within me now. I feel the light of loveliness within me now. I feel the name of God within me now. I choose the joy of God instead of pain. I choose the name of God instead of pain. I choose the light of non-relative beauty instead of pain. I choose the light of loveliness instead of pain. I choose the vision of oneness instead of pain. I choose the thought of God instead of pain. I choose the joy of God instead of pain. I have a function that God would have me fulfill. I have a function that God would have me fulfill. Yeah, the function is salvation. The function is choosing the vision of oneness. I place the future in the hands of God. I place the future in the hands of God. I place the future in the name of God. I place the future in the vision of oneness. I place the future in the light of loveliness. I place the future in the light of pure, clear, transparent, wide open beauty. I place the future in the hands of God. Love is the way I walk in gratitude. Vision is the way I walk in gratitude. The name of God is the way I walk in gratitude. The light of loveliness is the way I walk in gratitude. The light of beauty is the way I walk in gratitude. I am not a body. I am free. I am not a body. I am free. This body is just part of the machinery that is designed to try and change reality. But I am not that machinery at all. I've just been working on it, just trying to design it. But I am not that machine. I am not a body. I am free as God created me. I am free as God created me. And the vision of oneness reminds me of my freedom. There is no peace except the peace of God. There is no peace except the peace of God. There is no peace from the ego. There's only peace from God, the peace of God, the vision of oneness. There is no peace except the vision of oneness. There is no peace except the light of loveliness. There is no peace, God. There is no other source of peace. Peace to my mind. Let all my thoughts be still. Peace to my mind. Let all my thoughts be still. Let all my thoughts be still, and let me have just the thought of God. Let me have just the vision of oneness. Let me have just the light of beauty. Let me just have the name of God. Let me just have that light of loveliness that lights up the entire world. Let me have just that, and let all other thoughts be still. Just that one thought. God is with me. I live and move in Him. God is with me. I am reminded by the vision of oneness that God is with me. I see God everywhere. I see the reminder of God everywhere, and I know that God must be with me because I see this reminder resting upon everything. My home awaits me. I will hasten there. My home awaits me. I will hasten there. My home awaits me. I will hasten there. But I've forgotten. So, how do we hasten there? By being reminded, by accepting the reminder of what is my home like? Ah, I see this light of loveliness touching everything, bathing everything, abiding with everything, effortlessly, formlessly, transparently, intrinsically, tracelessly, abiding with everything, with residue-free, non-crystallizing light that is abiding with everything, touching everything, resting upon everything. Oh yes, I that reminds me, I remember my home. I will hasten there. Now I will hasten there for sure. This is my holy instant of release. This is my holy instant of release. This is my holy instant of release. This, as it is, this oneness, as it is my holy instant of release. This beauty, as it is the holy instant of my release. This one beauty, this one loveliness, this one name, this one thought, this one peace, this one joy is the holy instant of release. God condemn me not, no more do I. If God doesn't condemn us, then how can we condemn ourselves? Are we disagreeing with God? Are we saying we have a different will? God's will is that we're not condemned. So, I do not condemn myself, therefore, I do not wish to see a condemnation of myself or God. So let me let this light of loveliness rest upon the world, so that all condemnation may be lifted off the world, may be lifted off of me, may be lifted off of God. Let there be no condemnation. God condemns me not, no more so do I. Father, I will but to remember you. It is my one will. It is my one purpose. It is my one focus. It is my one meaning to remember God, to remember the Prime Creator, to remember the Kingdom, to remember the one reality without a second reality. That is my one purpose, and therefore I choose, I practice to accept the vision of oneness which reminds me of reality so I can remember. So I can remember, Father, I will but to remember you. That is our goal, to remember reality through the vision, allowing ourselves to see that there is this beautiful, immaculate, spaced out, wide open, non-crystallizing, genuine, authentic, all good, pure, clear, lovely light, light of loveliness that is bathing everywhere and everything. And this will enable us to remember God. God in His mercy wills that I be saved. It is God's will that I be saved from this monstrous machinery that I have made, from this terrible forgetfulness that I have indulged in. And so it is God's will that we accept the Holy Spirit's gift of salvation, the vision of oneness, the vision of beauty, God's name, the thought of God, the joy of God, the peace of God, the bliss of God, the gracefulness of God, the loveliness of God, the beauty of God, the vision of beauty, the core, pure matrix, centered heart, loveliness, bathing everything. I rule my mind, which I alone must rule. I rule my mind. It is my will that rules my mind. I cannot throw my will away. I am the ruler of my mind. Therefore, the power of decision rests with me. The power of decision rests with me. It cannot be taken away from me. I decide I want salvation. I decide I want to remember God. I decide I want to go home. I decide for the vision of oneness. I decide to see everything and everywhere equally bathed in this non-congealing, non-clumping, non-concretized, non-crystallized, smoothed out, still, silent, serene, calm, pure light of loveliness, light of beauty, bathing everything. I decide that, I choose that, I rule my mind. On my decision, all salvation rests. Yes, on my decision. It is my decision for this. Nobody else can say no. I rule my mind. I decide for this. On my decision, all salvation rests. Because the one choice, let me see the vision of oneness. That's my decision. It rests upon the entire machinery of forgetfulness, of attack, of delay, of madness, of whim. It rests upon all of it equally as it is. This instant, before any instant of time can take place, it rests upon it now. It rests upon it now. The glory of my Father is my own. The glory of my Father is my own. The glory is intrinsic. It is authentic. It is all good. It is all perfect. It is all-knowing, it is timeless, formless, uncomposed, unaligned, pure spaciousness, wide-open bliss. This glory is mine, and I will be reminded of it by seeing everything bathed in the light of loveliness, as it is, everything as it is. The holy instant, this holy instant is salvation come. Yes, this holy instant. Just this, as it is, this, as it is, salvation has come. Right now, right here, right now. It's everywhere. It is here now. It has come now. It is rests on my decision, and my decision only, that I rule my mind, I rule the decision. It is my will that salvation has come. The remembrance of God has come. This day is God's. It is my gift to Him. We are giving this day to God. We are giving this day to remembrance of God. This day is the day that God has set aside for us to practice, resolving our continuity fears so that we can say, yes, I have decided that I will see everything bathed in this lovely light, this non-wavering light, this non-dimmable light, this non-switchable light, this non-corruptible light. This non-flickering light, this non-trembling light, this steady light, this perfectly steady light, this perfectly still light. I have decided to give this day in practice towards this one and only meaningful goal that will bring salvation to the entire world. Today I will judge nothing that occurs. What good is judgment since this light of loveliness rests upon everything equally, just as it is, right now. My tiredness, my fatigue, my feeling of failure, depression, pain, suffering, misery, happiness, joy, anything, whatever the situation in this world is, right this instant, it rests upon all of it equally, right this moment. There is no need to judge anything. Judgment doesn't change that one iota, not one iota. Let me not see myself as limited. Let me not see myself as limited. Let me not see that the light of loveliness rests upon something and not on something else. Because that limits me. It limits my inheritance. It limits my remembrance of reality. So let not my remembrance of reality be limited in any way today. We are asserting the truth of reality. We are asserting the truth of reality. So, we are asserting that we are seeing today, we will see the non-reducible light of loveliness. We are seeing the undiminishable light of beauty. We are seeing the non-wavering thought of God. We are seeing the non-leaning light of beauty. We are seeing the favoritism-free vision of oneness. We are seeing the specialness-free grace of God. We are seeing the non-reactive light of beauty. We are seeing the balance-free name of God. We are seeing the non-engaging light of oneness. We are seeing the non-improving name of God. We are seeing the non-judgmental word of God, the non-judgmental word of God. We are seeing the non-referential thought of God, the non-referential thought of God. We are seeing the non-becoming light of loveliness. We are seeing the process-free vision of oneness. We are seeing the non-thoughtful light of clear, clear beauty. We are seeing the consideration-free name of God. We're seeing the action-free thought of God. We're seeing the non-energetic peace of God. We are seeing the non-preferential bliss of God. We are seeing the non-focused oneness of God. We are seeing the non-directed light of beauty. We're seeing the non-dancing word of God. We are seeing the non-imposing name of God. We are seeing the non-dual light of loveliness. We are seeing the non-timely name of God. We are seeing the non-rewarding vision of oneness. We are seeing the non-presenting thought of God. We are seeing the non-searching light of loveliness. We are seeing the non-finding vision of oneness. We are seeing the non-discovering word of God. We are seeing the non-pending name of God. We are seeing the non-ending light of beauty. We are seeing the non-striking thought of God. We are seeing the non-delivering word of God. We are seeing the non-interactive name of God. We are seeing the non-permissive light of loveliness. We are seeing the non-decisive light of beauty. This name, word, thought, loveliness, beauty, oneness of God is simply gently resting and bathe upon everything, gently bathing everything, and that's it. That is it. It is not judging. It is not presenting. It is not deciding. It is not acting. It is not processing. It is not compelling. It is not imposing. It is not directing anything. It's not balancing anything. And it's not delivering or striking or interacting or timing or rewarding or referencing or engaging or reacting or wavering or diminishing or reducing. It is not doing any of that whatsoever. It is not doing anything. All it's doing is without any motion, without any movement, without any action, it is simply bathing everything. Simply bathing everything. It is simply bathing everything. It is simply bathing everything in its intrinsic nature, in its traceless nature, in its identical nature, in its baseless, immutable nature, in its effulgent, non-concretized nature. in its ultimate non-reified nature, in its equally immutable nature, in its infallible, inseparable, groundless nature, in its mindless, transparent, locationless nature, in its uncontrived, changeless, formless nature, in its non-related, unalloyed, natural nature, in its spaced-out, all-good, non-related nature, in its non-other, supreme, undifferentiated nature, in its all-pervasive, authentic, as-it-is nature, in its non-congealing, unborn, non-defined nature, as its unceasing, core, non-crystallizing nature, in its ever-knowing, process-free, singular nature, in its one, wide-open, residue-free, non-compounded nature, in its non-fabricated, all-embracing, unelaborated nature, in its immaculate, singular, non-fixated nature. It is that. 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 It is that peace. It is that peace. It is that vision. It is that presence. It is that bliss. It is that freedom. It is that beauty. It is that everywhereness. It is that love. It is that oneness. It is that forgiveness. It is that purity. It is that nowness. It is that eternity. It is that spaciousness. It is that glory. It is that serenity. It is that silence. It is that timelessness. It is that sweetness. It is that beyondness. It is that inclusiveness. It is that identity, that wordlessness, that security. It is that belonging, that light, that gratefulness, that relief. It is that divinity. It is that agelessness. It is that smoothness. It is that effortlessness. It is that endlessness. It is that clarity. It is that seamlessness. It is that incorruptibility. It is that radiance. It is that boundlessness. It is that freshness. It is that abidance. It is that heart. It is that isness. It is that remembrance. It is that centeredness. It is that eternal life. It is that blessing. It is that assurance. It is that compassion. It is that self-releasedness. It is that carefreeness. It is that grace. It is that spontaneity. It is that holiness. It is that vision of oneness. It is that. It is that. This is that. This is that. It is that. It is that. It is that and only 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 that. So today, we give this day to that. We give this day to that. To that smoothness. To that purity of light. To that purity of beauty. To that smoothness of beauty, to that silence of beauty, to that love of beauty, to that freedom of beauty, to that heart of beauty. We give this day to that. What better purpose could there be for this day? Let all things be exactly as they are. Let all things be exactly as they are, as they are. And let this immaculate light of beauty rest upon everything as it is, so that we may be reminded of our home, and so we may hasten back home. It's that simple. So we may hasten back home. How else are we going to hasten back home if we're not reminded of our home? Because we've forgotten our home. How can we hasten home when we've forgotten what our home is? Where it is, what it is. We have to practice. We have to practice the realization that we don't need to practice, because the vision of oneness rests upon everything exactly as it is. Doesn't matter what the dance is. It makes no difference. It's undifferentiated light of beauty, undifferentiated non-judgmental light of beauty. However, makes no differentiation whatsoever of what it's resting upon. None. Because its only purpose is to remind us of God. Its only purpose is to bathe everything. It is the overflowing bath of the light of loveliness. It is the overflowing bath. It simply is continuously overflowing upon everything. It is continuously overflowing upon everything. It's this continuous overflow. There's no lack of it. There's no lack. It simply is bathing everything, everything. Because that's the new purpose we have, you see, is to be use what we made to remind us of reality. And how can we be reminded of reality unless we see everything as glorious, everything is beautiful, everything is overflowingly bathed in oneness. Overflowingly bathed in oneness. Overflowingly bathed in oneness. So may we all be overflowingly bathed in the peaceful bliss of oneness. May we all be overflowingly bathed in the pure, clear, wide open spaciousness of the light of beauty. Okay. So, you see, this is all spontaneous. It is all simply determination. It is all simply deciding, let's give it a try. Even though we know we're very feeble and imperfect in our practicing and don't know what the results, how quick they would come, can't really measure it. But we just have faith. We have faith that this will have a positive momentum builder. It's a positive momentum builder, and I say that it is. But again, preserve your momentum. So I will continue to see what I can do to preserve my momentum. You continue to do the same. And guard your momentum. Continue with your momentum. The results will come of their own accord. You will remove your comfort zone. You will remove your comfort zone. And where your comfort zone is, that's where you are. That's where you'll find yourself. Where your comfort zone is, that's where you will find yourself. That's where you will be. So we move our comfort zone, that's where we are. All right. So may the great overflowing bliss of the overflowing light of loveliness that is overflowingly bathing everything in the light of beauty, and the effortless, formless, timeless, non-crystallized oneness. May that vision dawn upon us. May that vision dawn upon us. Okay, that's it for this one.